Dr. Carlene Byfield is an assistant professor of nursing at Queensborough who does extraordinary work with people in desperate need of healthcare in one of the poorest parts of the world. We will talk about that shortly, but welcome, Carlene, and thank you so much. And I'm sorry I'm not there in the studio with you. Before we talk about Haiti and your work there, let's talk about Queensborough and your journey here. How did that happen?
That is a very interesting story. So I worked on my master's in nursing education at New York University. And while I was at New York University as a student, I heard the buzz about Queensborough and how Queensborough's nursing program is leading New York with the state boards, the NCLEX pass rate. So our students take the state board exam for their certification in nursing. And we look at the pass rate from different schools. And during the meetings at NYU, because I was a nursing education student there, I had to attend all the faculty meetings. And the buzz was just about Queensborough and that NCLEX pass rate. And Queensborough is a community college. How do they get their NCLEX pass rate so high? Again, in practice, on another occasion, I heard it in the hospital where I worked at the time that we will only take Queensborough's associate degree program students because everyone was looking for bachelor's prepared students, nurses. But we will take Queensborough students because they're always well prepared. So on graduation from NYU, they offered me a job to teach there immediately on graduation. So I started to teach at NYU and I left clinical practice. So I taught clinical simulation there. And even through that time, the buzz was still about Queensborough. And I just wanted to be a part of that. So I went to Northeastern University to acquire a doctorate degree. And while I'm at Northeastern, all the way in Boston, one of my instructors was talking with me, and she had taught at NYU, and I didn't know that. So during the conversation, she mentioned that, you know, you will get a job teaching anywhere, but Queensborough is a good place to start because they have a booming NCLEX pass rate. And I said, this is meant to be. So I applied at Queensborough. And here I am at Queensborough. It's been a wonderful journey. The day I came here for the interview, I was wowed by the campus. It was so beautiful, and I just couldn't wait to start working here. The students, when I started to work here, they had my heart immediately. The students are different from students anywhere else.
How so? Tell me.
They are eager to learn. They are invested in their learning. They try to establish a good relationship with their instructors. And it's just a different culture. They make you want to teach them. So I really do enjoy being here and working at Queensborough.
You had worked with nurses caring for children, and I know that had an impact. Tell me about that.
I worked at St. Mary's Hospital for Children as a nursing supervisor. And during my time there, I realized that the nurses are leaving home to come, and many of them have children, to come to the hospital to take care of other people's children. From talking to the nurses, I realized that it took a lot for them to leave their children at home and to give service to other people's children. So the nurses have, in pediatrics, it's a very different setting, and especially with the special needs population. It is a lot of interacting with the parents. And sometimes when parents have children with special needs, they have very high anxiety level, and it requires a different level of skill to work and interact with those patients to get them to understand that the nurses are working in the best interest of their child. And especially so, St. Mary's is a subacute facility. And these children are transferred from a major acute care setting to the subacute. And the level of care is very different. So the parents come to St. Mary's expecting the same type of monitoring, the same type of interventions that were given at the acute care facility. It's kind of hard for the nurses to help them to understand the concept that your child is now in a safe place. Your child is now in a better position as it relates to healing. And this is why the child is now safe to be in a subacute and does not require the acute care anymore. So that takes a toll on the nurses, because sometimes the families do not understand that. And they don't understand it because it is their child. And they're also traumatized by having a child with special needs. So the nurses are quite often burnt out. And I did a survey to see how are the nurses coping? How is this affecting them mentally, physically? And the survey showed that the nurses are burnt out and they need help, and that intervention was required. So I developed this professional resilience training program, and I implemented that training program over a period of time. That was actually my dissertation for my doctorate, and I was already working here at Queensborough. I had just started here at Queensborough, so it was a challenge to go to St. Mary's at nights to implement the training, because I had to train all the staff on all the different shifts, the weekends, the nights, the evening shift, the day shift. So I trained the staff and I did a post survey to see the effect that the training had on the staff, this professional resilience training program. What effect did it have on the staff? And there were positive outcomes. So that was a very, very good project, because the nurses are still now using some of the interventions that I taught them and how to be professionally resilient.
Nurses certainly have been under a lot of strain these 2 years. What are you teaching at Queensborough in that regard?
I did consider that actually during the pandemic. We didn't have a training program for our students. We didn't have a virtual in our semester. I teaching nursing 102, and we did not have an online or a virtual clinical experience for our students. And I developed an online clinical program for our students for nursing 102 for the entire semester. So during the development of this course for my semester, I embedded strategies, coping strategies for nurses and for the students going into the hospital during the pandemic. And during my teaching and the debriefing with the students, I had them talk about how do they feel? How is this affecting you? It was more like a support group. So the clinical pre-conference was changed from just focusing on patients. What are you going to do for your patient? Here's a disease process. This is what you know. I had to shift that to make it half about the students and half about the patients. So I would start by asking the students, how do you feel? How is this affecting you? What are your emotions? Let's talk about your emotions. And I also let students know that if you have any individual needs, please reach out to me, because there are still resources virtually on the college that can assist you. So that is how I helped my students to cope during the pandemic.
You've spoken to me about how motivated Queensborough students are, and it makes them stand out, that motivation, that they're perhaps driven in ways that are different to other nursing students. What was your motivation for becoming a healthcare professional?
Thank you for asking that. So growing up in Jamaica, I watched my great-grandparents age, and I would quite often be the one to go to the doctors with them because my parents were overseas and I was the oldest of my siblings. So I was responsible for going to the doctors with them and reporting to my parents. So I was just pushed into the role of the caregiver for my great-grandmother as she got older and could not help herself anymore. And the passion developed there. I watched her as in the mornings, how she was down, she felt sick. And then when I washed her up and fed her, how she perked up and she verbalized how better she was feeling. And that went to my core that, geez, you can actually help a sick person to feel better through simple interventions, just washing them up, talking with them, feeding them. Simple things that can help another person to feel better. And so I have always wanted to be a teacher. Before I acquired that role, during my elementary school years, I was obsessed, and my parents knew this, with being a teacher. So what caring for her and going to the doctors with her and watching how the nurses treated her, I identified things that, this is what I would like to do for a patient. This is what I would not do for a patient. And then I started to see how I could fit in that helping role. And that's why I went to nursing school.
Has there ever been a moment in your education career where you've thought, no, I can't do this. This is not what I had in mind. Or maybe when you were in your practice, you came across a situation where you thought, I should be doing something else?
It happens all the time. So there are times when you encounter some very challenging patients. And I would say to myself, geez, I should have gone into teaching. That's what I really wanted to do. And at the time, I didn't know that, and I didn't think about that I could have the best of both worlds. So there were times when I questioned myself, why didn't I pursue education? That's what I really wanted to do. And then I go home and I reflect on how I made the patients feel that day. I reflect on all the things that I had done that day, and it made me want to go back the next day. So yes, I do get those reservations from time to time. Well, I used to, until I discovered that I can still teach. I can be a nurse and an educator and a teacher. And now I have the best of both worlds.
Carlene, how much has the nursing profession changed since COVID started?
This pandemic has helped the nation to really appreciate nurses. I have always had the feeling that nurses are underappreciated, and everyone talks about the doctors and the role of the doctors and what they do. And if you look at studies, various studies are out there that talks about the medical field, and they focus on the medical field, but not so much on nurses and what we actually do. For example, when you get to an emergency department, for the most part, it is the most vulnerable moment of anyone's life, because an emergency means that you need, for the most part, emergent care in order to sustain your life. And the first person you will encounter is always a nurse. When you go to the triage booth, it's a nurse that determines your level of illness and how quickly you should be seen. It's a nurse that comes to your bedside to administer care, to initiate that life-saving measure. It's very rarely a doctor. Yes, the doctor will write the orders and give direction, but it's the nurse that actually carries out the task. Because if that doctor sits at that desk and write the orders, that cannot save your life. Someone has to actually implement that intervention. And so I the pandemic has helped many people to realize the role of nursing in healthcare. So I feel that there are more studies I've been looking, and there are more studies now that talk about the nurse's role. And I feel that's going in the right direction.
Public health, of course, is certainly center stage due to COVID. But public health, I know, has been important to you way before that, which brings me to your work in Haiti. Tell me about the project you're involved in. How were you introduced to the need there on the ground?
I was introduced to the need in Haiti by telling a colleague in practice about, you know, in a casual conversation. She's from Haiti. And I told her when I was growing up as a little girl how fascinated I was with the history of Haiti. In Jamaica, in our history class, we learned about many different cultures and throughout the Caribbean, and Haiti was one of the countries that they taught us about, and how Haiti gained independence. And from the history classes, I developed a passion for the history of Haiti, learning how they fought the French with very little resources, just strategies, how they built Christophe Henry, and he built the fort in Citadel, and from the building the forts on the high points of the mountains, that they were able to see the ocean and see when the French were coming in, because they come by sea. Being up high in the mountain, they were able to defeat them. And it's just very interesting what they went through, that revolution in the 18th century. It was just very interesting to see how they fought and won with the very little resources that they had. It showed the resilience of the people. And, you know, when I visited Haiti, I was telling her about that passion. And she said, well, maybe you could come and help us, because we have a foundation where a bunch of us nurses formed. And we go to Haiti to provide free medical care to the people there, because they have very little health care. And I said to her, I would love to do that. It is voluntary work. I would love, not only would I love to, you know, be of service to my fellow mankind, I would love to really go for other reasons, which I'll tell you about. And she said, yes. So we're going in April, and this was probably the year before. It was 2015, December, about that we had that conversation. And then they told me that they're going in April, and it was right around spring break. And it just so happened that I needed some hours for my program at Northeastern University. So the medical mission would have counted for many hours of clinical practice. So it worked out on many different levels for me. So that's how I joined the organization and went to Haiti with them. And, you know, it's been very, very rewarding.
How so? What's particularly been valuable to you that you've learned in Haiti?
We want to teach equitable learning, inclusive teaching for equitable learning in our classroom. And, you know, I wanted to look at how is education and nursing education, how is it delivered in other countries? How do they teach their nursing students? Because Queensborough has a very diverse population of students. They're coming from all over the world. And if you have some background knowledge of, you know, how education is delivered elsewhere, you're better able to provide conditions for equitable learning within your classroom. Because you now understand that people learn differently. You could meet them where they are as to how the structure of education that they're accustomed to. And that helped me. So I went to Haiti, and what I told you that I when I was a little girl, learning about their strength and their drive, I still saw that even through the devastations. You walk the streets and you see the children sitting in my hotel room looking out the window at night. And there are like 10 children sitting outside at 10 o'clock at night on the sidewalk. And they all had books in their hands. And I couldn't figure 10 o'clock and you see them going, it's the bugs that's biting them, right? And I'm like, why don't they go home? Only to be told they're using the light from the hotel building to do their homework and to study. Simple thing as light, they don't have at night. They had to leave their homes, sit in the alleyway of the hotel building to use the lights that's shining from the floodlight on the building to do their homework and to study.
You first went in 2016. What did you see and who did you treat?
We treated 1,500 patients in a day. We started at 6 a.m. We ended at 6 p.m. And the army had to be outside guarding people, only letting in 20 people onto the campus per time because it would have been a stampede because people came from all over the country from the day before to wait outside of the school for healthcare. And as a matter of fact, there was this one lady that collapsed in our hands while we were treating her. Her pressure was so high that she collapsed. And she can't go to the hospital because if she goes to the hospital, they're not taking her unless she has the money up front to pay. So we had to lift her up, put her in a truck, get her to the hospital, and pay for it. And we were able to save that lady. But it was devastating because you saw children who had no health care at all. You're looking at their teeth. For young children, they're losing their teeth. They have toothache. And they'll tell you, I have been suffering with toothache for 3 months. No painkiller. So it was primarily infections from the dirty water with women with a lot of yeast infection, hypertension, diabetes, high cholesterol that we treated.
Do you plan on going back?
I am not going to go for now because of the level of crime. One, it's not safe. I do not speak the language. I need interpreter. Two, even people from Haiti are not going. The organization has put that on a pause because of the kidnapping, the murders, even the Haitian president was assassinated. So it's definitely not a safe time. But what I wanted to do and what I was looking forward to is a partnership with a college. Surprisingly, when I got to Haiti, there were other schools there on medical mission with their students. And I really wanted to see how can I get my students at Queensborough to go to see how healthcare is delivered elsewhere. We talk about global health nursing, but it would be nice for students to see it firsthand. And how would this help student nurses here? They can now see how healthcare is being delivered elsewhere and identify what role are they going to play in their career. It gives them direction. I think it would give them a sense of direction to see, you know, how people are treated in other countries, how education is delivered in other countries. And it would also help them to appreciate the education that they're getting here at Queensborough.
How has your experience in Haiti changed you?
It has changed me personally and professionally. I have a wider appreciation for my job, for the education that I have received, for the opportunity to work with students and the opportunity to help to contribute to healthcare on a broader level, such as providing nurses to go out there. And because I know that, I identify that one of the best ways of contributing to healthcare is by providing healthcare providers. And so I play a role. I developed more appreciation for my role as an educator. So that helped me professionally. It also helped me professionally that in the classroom, I'm now better able to meet my students where they are. I have identified that people's background play a significant role in their learning, in how they learn. And knowing this, it helps me to structure my teaching, my instruction a little differently.
I know everything you teach is important, but Carlene, what is the most important issue that you raise with your students?
I think it's compassion. Nursing begins with compassion. And I will bring this back to Haiti. While I was there, I realized the students did not show compassion to their patients. And I learned how meaningful it can be when you hold a person's hand. You may not have the resources to help them, but simply holding the hand and letting them know that I care, I'm here for you, I'm going to try to help you. It is truly meaningful because that provides a sense of relief. It shows a level of humanity. And I feel that's the most important aspect that I teach my students. When you go to this bedside, it's a person. Don't view this person as a patient. View the person as the person who they are. Talk to them. And I try to tell my students, if you have the time, pull up a chair and sit and talk to your patient. And I'm going to tell you one of the reasons why I teach my students that. Some of my most important lessons in nursing came from my patients, not from the book. When I learned, for example, about diabetes, it was really from a patient that gave me the nuts and bolts about diabetes, because I sat at the bedside and I spoke to the patient, and the patient told me how the symptoms started, what was his experience. And, you know, those are the same questions on the exam. And you remember it because you heard it firsthand from a patient, not trying to memorize it from a textbook. So I tell them compassion is very important. Because when someone feels that you care, that's the first step in healing. So I try to teach them how to be compassionate.
Dr. Carlene Byfield, thank you so much. I've really enjoyed our conversation. Thank you for sharing all those stories with us about Haiti and about your personal education and your experience here at Queensboro. And thanks again for being in the studio.
You're welcome. Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Bye for now.